into what in generations past was called the Queen of Sciences, theology. And theology is faith seeking understanding. And it's not the other way around. It's not, theology is not understanding seeking faith. Because faith is not an intellectual pursuit. Faith is something that we experience in the depths of our hearts and souls and throughout life. And we become aware of our faith at certain critical moments, peak experiences. We get in touch with it through a moment of inspiration or insight that seems to come out of nowhere. Perhaps it happens to you when you're up on a mountain and you're with nature, and all of a sudden you feel a sense of something. We call that the numinous. Or you're at the beach walking along the seashore, your feet is feeling the sand and the salty water of the surf coming up over your feet, and you look out at the great expanse of the Pacific as you see the sunset descending into the horizon. And you have this moment, this feeling that you can't describe. That feeling is the numinous. You can't create it. We try to do it artificially because it is a feeling that gives us a sense of transcendence. It is almost like a kind of ecstasy. And or sometimes when we see a great work of art, a beautiful cathedral, a piece of architecture like that, or when we read the words of a great poet, or when we're sitting in a concert and we hear a song that just deeply moves us. And then we try to replicate the experience and we cannot do it. A great example of that I gave you last week was when you're listening to a radio and a new song comes on a radio you've never heard before, and it just transports you to another place. You're just so deeply moved and it's so exciting that immediately you go out and purchase the song. Now, when I was young, I would go to the record store and buy a record, but then it was CDs, and now I don't know how they get music nowadays, but yeah. You know, so, but nonetheless, you have this experience, and so you play the song again, and you really love it. You share it with others because you want them to have the same experience you have, and you're saying, isn't that cool? But the second time you have it, you do not have that same experience again, but you do have the memory of it. And that's why you keep playing the song over and over again, hoping to get the experience back. And so it stirs a kind of longing and desire within your heart. And you're not quite sure what it is that you're longing for. But it is a feeling that makes you feel, it's hard to describe, there's no words, it transcends language. But what I'm saying is that we have spiritual experiences. It is hardwired into our humanity. So we have spiritual experiences. And because we're social creatures, we try to share that with others or have the experience at the same time. This is why it's more fun going to the movie theater and watching a movie than doing it by yourself at home with the television, at least for most people, because you're having this big, even with strangers, you're having a common human experience together with others. And so you hear the laughter in the theater, which makes it more fun to go to the movies. We like to have shared experiences. And this is why we gather in great numbers to hear a concert, because we want to have the shared experience, not just sit at home and listen to it. So the shared spiritual experience is what religion is. Religion is a social effort to for us to have spiritual experience simultaneously together as a group, because it's always more powerful. An example of that is that I used to play the guitar. I say I used to, because then I married a musician who really plays the guitar, and then but when I was in school, in seminary, I hope I didn't destroy something here, When I was in school and seminary, and after a long day of study, I would like to come home to my place where I lived and pull out my guitar, and I would just be playing by myself the guitar. And that would relax me. I was having an experience with the music. Some of you are play instruments, and you know what I'm talking about. It's a tremendous release. And I would do improvise and that sort of thing. I think, Michael, you play the guitar, don't you? Yeah, but you know the experience. It's a great feeling. And I can have I can really get into it. And I can do whatever I want on the guitar. Well, within the limitations of my limited ability. And then someone could walk in the room and while I'm playing the guitar, and then they can listen and maybe appreciate what I'm doing. Maybe not. Maybe they don't like it. But then, and that is a one level experience, but it's still my experience. But there is another kind of experience that's based on that, and that is if I pull out my guitar and start playing and I have other musicians around me or other people playing instruments with me, maybe even different kinds of instruments, and then all of a sudden we're doing it together, but now I don't have as much freedom. We have to ritualize our action in order to produce a common musical experience, but we're all adding to it, and it intensifies the experience. It really is much more exciting. Even though I could have a great experience by myself, it's more exciting when there's others playing the instruments and you have these like jam sessions in the garage or something like that, garage band. And that's the energy that is produced by that experience. I use this as a way by analogy to explain what religion is versus individual spirituality. I can have a spiritual experience all by myself, but if I can share it with another, it intensifies that experience. And so we invent religious rituals and practices so that we can do things together as a group. Maybe each one's doing a different part of it, but it really elevates and lifts the experience to a higher level. So religion is the social expression of human spirituality. It's human spirituality that is organized and put into, given a language, and put into a way that we all can do it at the same time. We can all pray at the same time, or all worship, and whatever that worship form is, singing, dancing, processions, the mass, all of these things. That we do, and it's a universal human phenomenon. Human beings are spiritual by nature. It's a part of us. We all have these experiences, even atheists have them. That's the thing. And then there are this effort by every single culture and society to try to do this together, and so every culture and society has invented their own religion. But it's a way to express that which is inexpressible, yet it is real to us. So I said in the past, I'm religious because it's the human thing to do. It's in my humanity. And to deny that impulse, my spirituality, I'm diminishing my own humanity. Does that make sense? That's what we've talked about so far in last week's. And we got into... already I've misspelled a word. Anthropology. So, in the beginning, where we start in our theological inquiries, we start with ourselves and our own experience. That's where all religion begins. That's where all theology begins. Theology does not create religion. The experience creates religion, and theology now is the afterthought. What does this mean? And we begin to ask questions because we want to understand this aspect of our experience as human beings. So we start with ourselves. That's that study of the nature of my humanity and the nature of humanity in theology is called anthropology. And this word anthropology was coined by theologians. It then, in the beginning of the modern period, You know, in the last, just the last few hundred years, it has branched off and become its own scientific discipline. And you will find that this is true with all of the scientific disciplines that you find in a university. Universities were created in order to study the mystery of our spirituality and the mystery of God. The universities were more interested in theology. Then theology breaks down into areas of interest and areas of study. Anthropology is one of them. And then as time went on, anthropology developed into the study of human culture and the study of human evolution. So you have out of this cultural anthropology and physical anthropology. But it began as a theological inquiry. This is why theology is called the queen of the sciences. Everything, even the scientific method, was created by theologians before it became a separate discipline and endeavor. Most Americans forgot this. Most people don't think of it. In fact, they think somehow all these other disciplines are somehow anti-religion or anti-theological. It's not the case. I was recently reading an article saying that really everybody should study theology. Not that they're going to, even people who are not believers. Because if you study theology, you will better understand our own culture and civilization. You'll understand where things came from in our intellectual development as human beings, especially in our own culture here in America. But most people have no, they don't make these connections. I hope you don't mind I point these things out to you. Is this dull and boring so far?
Please do.
Okay. All right. Okay, good. So now this week we're going to move to the next question in our theological inquiry. What is the nature of the world in which we live? What is the nature of the world? We thought about ourselves, anthropology. Now, what is the nature of the environment in which we live? And we have been observing this world ever since we can think as Homo sapiens. So this inquiry into the nature of the world is called cosmology. Have you heard that word before? Now it's usually associated with the science of astronomy. But before astronomy was astronomy, it was astrology. And it's looking out at the universe, that, as far as we are able to observe, in a kind of awe and wonder and thinking about what is the meaning of the world? What do we observe about the world around us? Now, where does this word come from? Cosmos comes from the Greek word, and I'll just write it in English letters, cosmos, with a kappa, and it's the Greek word for the world. It's simply what it means. So cosmology is the study of the world or the universe. So when we start talking about the origins of the universe, this is a cosmological question in the realm of theology. So theology is the big overarching, a field in which we are doing our study, and then it's broken up into all these various aspects. And one aspect of theology, which we are going to look at tonight, is called cosmology. It is our understanding of what is creation. And when I use the word creation, I'm already revealing a theological bias, right? Because I'm saying it's something that was made. When you say creation, it's something that was made, which implies there was a time it wasn't here before. And so Christian theologians refer to cosmology as the teaching about creation, because we believe that the universe was created. Yes?
Is that a capital C creation?
I guess, yeah. I'm using it in as a...
No, I meant creation in general, or creation as done by God, or...
Yeah, yeah. Oftentimes we use creation as another way of saying the universe. Like we say all of creation. Even non-religious people will refer to all of creation. But when we say creation, we are making a statement of belief, that we believe that the world is a created artifact. Created by a power obviously much higher than human beings. And this is astonishing because as far as human beings know, in our experience, the highest, most sophisticated form of being is humanity. We don't know of anything higher and more intelligent than human beings, but we do know this. We're not responsible for the existence of the universe. Something or someone else has caused this to happen. And as Christians, we say that someone is, or that something is divinity, and that someone is God. Okay, let's go to your worksheets. Now that I've given you this introduction, are you with me so far? Are you having a good time? I hope you are.
Yep.
Okay. Okay, good. The reason I ask you that question, because when I was studying this stuff in seminary, I was totally bored. And so I'm trying to make this really exciting for you. Okay.
Are you still bored?
No, actually, I'm excited. The area of Christian theology, are you with me in your worksheet? Follow along. The area of Christian theology that is concerned with the nature of the universe is called cosmology. I already wrote it for you, cosmology. From the Greek words cosmos, the world, and logos. Logos would mean reason, words, or thoughts. The word as in the study of. A, we live in a universe whose sheer enormity staggers our imagination. And most of the time, we're living in our little boxes. I got to tell you a story. I've been having people from India coming here to the United States to be with us here at St. Matthew's. And they would stay at my house for a time until they got themselves another place. And I was one of the, we brought an Indian priest over from India by the name of Father Chinappa, but he now goes by Father Paul for obvious reasons. Chinappa was staying at our house for a couple of months, and it was just a great experience. And he would like to go on walks in the evening at sunset. Did I tell you the story before? Oh, okay. You want to hear it again? Okay. All right. Thanks, Steve. Anyway, so I said, well, sure, I can go for a walk. And he wanted to go because he says, in India, people like to go for walks in the evening. I said, well, yeah, we can do that. So we're walking out in our neighborhood, and he's totally astonished because there's nobody out. He says, where is everybody? Because in India, everybody in the evening goes out and walks the streets and they talk to their neighbors and all that. So the streets of India are full of people in the evening, taking an evening walk and talking to their neighbors. It's a big social moment. And he says, where are all the people? And I said, in their houses. In their houses, but it's evening, they should be out walking. And I said, no, Americans like to stay in their houses. And so we live in this big box, and then we get out of our house and we go into a smaller box with wheels, and we drive around in our boxes and we go into another box. So, oh, hi, I know why you're here. I know why you're
purse in your car.
You did
today.
Yeah, I was going to bring it by your house.
That's okay. I got to go buy groceries for Yeti.
Yeah. Okay. This is the you know where my car is.
Any to begin with.
Oh, okay.
That alas is the reality.
Yeah. So you know how to do that.
Okay. Sorry to interrupt.
No problem. So anyway, I tell this little and I got to tell the rest of the story. Anyway, so we're walking down the street, and he's just astonished that Americans don't walk anywhere. They get in their cars and drive, and that Americans like to stay in their houses. And so we're walking through the neighborhood, and in the distance, as we're going up this little incline in the road, we can see a couple approaching us. And I said, well, there you are. There's someone out walking. And as we approached them, it became obvious to me the woman was wearing a sari and they were from India. And as they approached us, we greeted them and they spoke the same language, because in India, different groups speak different languages. They happened to be from the same state that Father Chinnappa was, and so they spoke Telugu to each other and all of that. And so the only people walking in our neighborhood was another couple from India. So the reason I say that is because in our culture, we have become so separated from the world of nature. If you go out and look at the night sky tonight, you see a few stars, but you do not see the Milky Way and the glory of the heavens that the ancients would look at. There was no electric light pollution. People would step out and they would look and they would behold the glory of uncountable heavenly bodies. And they were moved to awe when they would see this. So there was a reason why I was telling you that story. But, we live in a universe whose sheer enormity staggers our imagination. And if your imagination is not staggered, it's because you're living in your box. Go outside in the desert and all of a sudden, your imagination will be staggered by the sheer size of the universe. Yeah.
Thank you.
You got it? Oh, and I got my keys. Okay, Martha. Okay, keep the faith. I wish you were too.
Can I share something a little bit?
Yeah, go right ahead.
Obviously, you know, before all the trees and all the houses and the roads and the cars and everything, maybe like 500 years ago, let's say, it's not that long ago, but it was here, because here there was nothing but, you know, the ancestors, you know, the people that lived here. And they could see, at that time, they could see the Milky Way.
Yeah.
Which we are part of, this galaxy, it's our galaxy. And so they called it Piwichahuta, which means the ribbon, the white ribbon, or the white half of the stars. I wish we could see it. And you could go maybe out to desert, maybe not far from here, and maybe we could see a little bit of glimpse. But I think it's just phenomenal.
Yeah.
And but we our ancestors believed that when you go to the sacred resting grounds of the people, that you walk on that ribbon of stars called Pupita.
Oh, yeah.
To get to that place.
So they had a sense of the numinous.
Yes, they did.
Yeah. So, back to A. The size, age, and complexity of this world is incomprehensible. Incomprehensible. Is that right? Okay, incomprehensible. Isn't that a great word? In other words, it's beyond words. It's more than we can even grasp with our, even though our minds and our brains are quite advanced, we still cannot comprehend or take in all of the world that we look at. So the complexity of this world is incomprehensible to our very limited powers of understanding. To gaze upon the grandeur of the heavens and the marvels of the earth that we call our home has always filled us with an overwhelming sense of wonder and awe. B, through the ability of the sensory, S-E-N-S-O-R-Y, perceptions, granted us, we have been able to observe and to think about the world in which we live. It's sensory perceptions, P-E-R-C-E-P-T-I-O-N-S. Got that? Throughout the ages of human history, we have tried to imagine through both myth and science what the world is really like and how it came to exist. Okay. Any thoughts so far? You see where we're going? Okay. We're laying a foundation here. C. It seems that in every human culture, there have been myths describing the creation of all that we observe in this world. that we find ourselves in. There are as many creation stories as there are human cultural groups. So every cultural group has a creation mythology or story. Most all of these various creation myths share some common features, that the world is a result of purposeful, and intentional, purposeful and intentional actions by a powerful being or beings, that the world emerged through a kind of supernatural activity that transformed a primordial chaos into the well-ordered pattern of the present world in which we live. Did you get all that? That's a big, long sentence. Purposeful, intentional, supernatural, chaos, and pattern were the words. We cannot help, for some reason, we always, when we're studying and observing the world, we speak as though the world is the product of intentionality. Now, religious people do that intentionally. But what I find interesting is that you have agnostic and atheistic scientists. Not all scientists are. There are many scientists are people of faith and are religious. But I watch science documentaries because I didn't get much science in seminary, you know. So I'm just fascinated about all the scientific explanations of the world, nature films and all that. But as I'm listening and watching these nature documentaries on TV, what strikes me is, even though they're scientific, that they sound very religious to me, because they talk about nature as if nature had understanding and intentionality. Have you ever noticed that? You can't escape. You slip into, you know, like they talk as if nature had a purpose and a design for the evolution of life, you know, and so nature does this, nature does that, nature made this decision, as if nature somehow is intelligent. Have you noticed that? So they give themselves away. And I was thinking, what's the difference between their nature and my God? It's both a power behind it all, causing things to happen. So it's rather funny to me. Okay, I forgot where I am. Oh, D, good thing. I was just seeing if you were paying attention. Of all the various explanations of the existence of the universe, both mythological and scientific, there are really only two common ideas. Here it is. Number one, that the universe is in and of itself eternal, without beginning or end. Or two, that the universe is finite, F-I-N-I-T-E, finite, which means there was a time the universe did not exist. That's what we mean. The universe is not eternal. When you say it's finite, the universe came into being, and the universe is slowly decaying and will eventually go out of being. So you have the view that the universe is finite, having a beginning from a cause outside or beyond itself, and that the universe will someday come to an end. Those are the only two choices ultimately you have. It is either eternal or finite. Yes?
It wasn't really until the validation of the Big Bang theory that the finite universe had validity, which atheists hate.
Yeah.
In fact, it's a finite universe.
Yeah.
Because it implies a God.
Yeah. It used to be said by atheists and that you don't need a God to explain the universe. The universe was always here until astrophysicists discovered, no, it wasn't. And we now have evidence. And they can say things with such precision, like the universe is 13.5 billion years old. We know that now. Isn't that amazing? Looking at it, I couldn't tell you. For all I know, it was always here. But no, 13 and a half billion years. Now, that's a long, long time ago compared with my puny little existence life here. But still, it's not eternal. And that the Earth itself is 4.5 billion years old, and that life on the Earth appeared about 500 million years after the Earth came into existence. Isn't that amazing? So science is telling us that. So it looks like the universe is not eternal. So how do you explain its existence unless something can come from nothing? And so far, we haven't been able to demonstrate in a laboratory that we can create something from nothing. It's an impossibility.
And the Gospel of John starts off, you know, with, if you know the story of the Big Bang Theory and how something came out of nothing, I mean, it describes it, basically.
Yeah.
In the beginning was the Word. I mean, that's all there was.
Yeah. Yeah, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him, and nothing that exists came into a being apart from Him. In Him was life, and that life was the light of man. And it goes on from there. Isn't that a wonderful passage? Yeah, it just blows my mind. Okay. Isn't theology fun? Are you having a good time? Okay, good. Roman numeral 2. The Christian cosmology is drawn from the Hebrew dash Jewish tradition. The Hebrew I need someone to write on the board for me. The Hebrew dash Jewish. That's where our ideas about the origin of the universe come from. The Hebrew cosmology is to be found in those portions of Hebrew scripture, that's the Old Testament, that were written in the exilic or post-exilic period. The later prophets, and especially the great hymn of creation that was added as a prologue to the book of Genesis. Now, so what does the Hebrew conception or cosmology looks like? Oh, by the way, the Hebrew cosmology comes from the Babylonians. That's really important. They had a way of viewing the world, and we're going to see that as we examine it more carefully. The following are characteristic features of Judeo-Christian cosmology. A, the universe is contingent. C-O-N. T-I-N-G-E-N-T. Contingent means dependent. There, when we think in terms of cause and effect, the universe is not a cause. It's not the cause of its own existence. The explanation of the existence of the universe cannot be found within the universe itself. The universe is dependent on something else. For its existence. The universe is an effect. We see the effect, but we cannot see the cause of the universe. But the Jewish, Hebrew-Jewish understanding, which is the Christian understanding, is that it is the product of the divine will. The divine will. In other words, God, divinity, the Creator intentionally and deliberately created the universe. It's not like a man walking down the street and wherever he walks, there's an effect, like he walks through a pile of leaves and the leaves just kind of scatter and the man is oblivious to that, not even thinking about it. The universe didn't come into existence because somehow that divinity, that Creator somehow was just, it was just an accidental effect. The universe is not an accident. The universe exists by the deliberate will and intentionality of the Creator. The universe is not the product of impersonal, random, or accidental events, but is the result of an intelligent, personal, and purposeful intention. That is the Christian assertion. The closest human analogy would be that The divine creator is like an artist creating a work of art. The universe is the artifact of God. And we are each pieces of that artifact. Are you having a good time still? Good. The universe, B, is finite. That is, finite, F-I-N-I-T-E. That is, the universe has a beginning and will have an end. Its existence is limited. There was a time when the universe did not exist. In fact, time itself is a characteristic of the universe. The universe is both time and space. Time and space came into existence with the universe. Outside of time and space is the eternal realm of the divine, and we have no idea what that's like or what that is. And there's no way that we can figure it out. C. Did you get time and space down, everybody? Okay. The divine creator transcends the universe. Transcends. T-R-A-N-S. C-E-N-D-S. And no, I never won the spelling bee. The divine creator transcends the universe. What do we mean by that? That outside or beyond the universe. The universe is a distinct reality called creation and is not to be confused with the creator, who is to be distinguished from the creation. God is, and I put it in quotes, outside of creation. God provides the ground of being for the universe. So that's what we mean that God transcends the universe. You may see a Van Gogh. Have you heard of the artist Van Gogh? Painting. It's beautiful. And as much as you stare at that, you will not find Van Gogh, the artist. You might gain some clues about his personality by his artistic tastes, what he has created. You could try to imagine what was in his mind when he created this work of art. But you will not find the person of Van Gogh in the painting. Literally, you will not find him. You may say he put a lot of himself into it, but you're still not going to find the artist in the painting. It's the same with creation as we as Christians understand it. You will never find God as another object alongside other objects within the universe. He put a lot of himself into the work creating the universe, but you will never find him in the work the artifact of the universe by observing the phenomenon around us. There is no microscope that's going to have you find the God atom, and there's no telescope that's going to be able to focus in on God and say, "Oh, there he is. Let's take a picture of him." He's not an object in the universe. This is why it was so silly when the first cosmonaut into space went up in a space capsule. You remember that story? This was before you were born, but this was a long time ago. Michael remembers it. Yeah. So the Russians beat us into space. They sent the first man into space, and as he was orbiting the Earth in his space capsule, he looked out the little window and looked out at outer space and everything was around. He says, "See, there's no God up here." Thinking that by making this statement, he had totally destroyed religious faith and religion. Because at that time, the Soviet government was officially an atheistic state. He totally misunderstood how Christians think of God. You're not going to be able to take a spaceship and go. Do you remember that one Star Trek movie where it was directed by William Shatner, and the whole point of the movie, let's go find God. So they fly to the very edges of the universe so that they could find God. Do you remember that episode? One of the movies? You don't remember it?
Stuck in the thing?
You know what? It was one of the worst Star Trek movies ever. Okay, and they meet an intelligent being out there and they think it's God. And the intelligent being plays along with it. You don't remember that story? And it turns out that he was very capricious and very evil, and they decided, no, he can't be God. Okay, anyway. You'll never be able to find God in the creation in the sense that God is like another object to be explored, like a rock or a tree or a planet. Yes?
In the same way that you really can't get to know an understanding of the person of Van Gogh by just being in a room full of his paintings.
Right.
You know, a lot of people think, well, I don't need to be involved in religion or church. I can get to know God by sitting on a mountaintop. Right? So you really can't get to know God sitting on a mountaintop. You can see the creation and appreciate the creation of God, but you can't get to know God by being in nature.
Yeah, you might get some clues of what he must be like. But still, we're very limited even at that. Okay. Where was I? D?
D.
The divine creator. Now, I just told you that the divine creator is outside, right, of the universe. I said he transcends the universe. Now I'm going to contradict that with the next line. The divine creator is present within the universe. Van Gogh is in the painting. Just chip away the paint, there he is. Okay. There is no place or time within the universe which escapes the divine presence. Okay? So it's a paradox. We affirm paradoxes. That's what faith does. So we say that God is outside the universe, and yet the presence of God is everywhere within. And we call that withinness of God immanence. So, God is not totally transcendent. And there are religions and philosophical beliefs that think that God is totally transcendent. This was the religion of what was called the deists. The deists, God created everything, but he left. He's done. It's like he's the watchmaker that created everything. He tossed it aside and he's on doing better, bigger and better things. He has no interest. He's not even thinking about us here. That's called deism, that saying that God is totally transcendent. Then you have God. So we not only affirm that God is transcendent, but we balance it out by saying that God is immanent, that God somehow is present within creation, within us. So we affirm what seems to be two propositions that contradict each other. That's called a paradox.
Is that we call this the divine paradox or the divine immanence?
Divine immanence is the word. Immanence. 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 Got it? Immanence. So that means that we're never very far from the presence of God. And when we say God is present, God is totally present. It's not like we got God's toe here on the earth and another part of God is somewhere else. God is fully present in every moment and in every space. And yet somehow transcends it all and is beyond it all. So we affirm these two opposite statements. And when you affirm two opposites as being true, we call that a paradox. Let me give you some examples of other paradoxes that we as Christians believe, particularly Catholics. Here's one that you say all the time. Virgin Mother. Huh? Right? That's a paradox. How can Mary be a virgin and a mother at the same time? Okay? It's a mystery. It's a paradox to us. We affirm both. Yes, she was a mother. Yes, she was a virgin. And then another paradox that we affirm quite commonly is that, who is Jesus? Well, he's divine. Okay. Oh, but he's also human. Well, he's both fully divine and fully human. Well, make up your mind. Which is he? Is he fully God or fully human? We do not say that Jesus is half God and half human. And we have that in mythology. Hercules is half God, half human. Remember? Who was Hercules' father?
Zeus.
Who was his mother? No one remembers his mother. But I'll tell you this much about his mother, which I don't remember her name. His mother was a human being.
You don't remember either.
I don't remember either, yeah. No one ever remembers the in history the mother, you know. Yeah. So anyway, Hercules is not fully human or fully divine. He's a third thing, a tertium quid. He is half and half. He is like a mule, right? A mule is neither a horse nor a donkey, but half and half, a hybrid. So, but when we talk about Jesus, we're not talking about Jesus who has a divine father and a human mother. Even though he has a divine father and a human mother, he's not half divine and half human. He is totally human and totally divine, and we can't explain it. It's a paradox. Both statements are affirmed to be true. Oh, what's that?
Alcmene. She was a Zeus fell in love with a beautiful Greek woman named Alcmene.
Can you spell it?
It's A-L-C-M-E-N-E.
Okay. Let's write that down, because it may be coming up on a quiz or something. Next time you play Trivial Pursuit. Do you remember that game? Do you remember Trivial Pursuit? Okay. What's that?
Yeah, you feel old. I love it.
Do you remember Trivial Pursuit?
I still play it.
You still play it? Gosh. That was the big game in the 80s, wasn't it? In the 60s, it was Twister. So we got more sophisticated in 20 years' time.
It says here that he actually had three parents.
Okay.
Two mortal and one divine. He was raised by Amphitryon, Tryon, and Alcmene, however you say her name.
Yeah.
A human king and queen who were cousins and grandchildren of Zeus's son, Perseus. But his biological dad was actually Zeus himself.
Okay. Okay, that's not Jesus. We're talking about Heracles. What?
My brain went kind of a funny place, but when we were talking about Jesus is not a hybrid, I came up with a bumper sticker that I thought was really great.
Well, what?
Jesus is not a Prius.
Jesus is what?
Jesus is not a Prius.
Jesus is not a Prius. Oh, very good.
If I know what that means, visit St. Matthew.
Yeah, come to St. Matthew. We'll explain it. We'll explain it to you. Okay. Now, what are some of the other things that Christians believe about creation or the Creator? D, the divine Creator is present within the universe. I think I already did that one. Yeah. We're on E. The universe is essentially good, is what we say. It is good because the Creator is good and is the source of all that is good. F, the universe is orderly. It is orderly because the Creator is wise and is the source of all knowledge and understanding. G, Christianity affirms that the creative action of God is a collaboration. Collaboration. C-O-L-L-A. B-O-R-A-T-I-O-N, of the three divine persons of the Godhead, which we call the divine life. The Father decrees the act of creation by the divine will. The Son, the eternal Word of God, is the divine agency through whom the will of the Father is carried out. The Holy Spirit is the divine power in whom the will of the Father through the agency of the Son is realized. So you can see the Christian Trinity. And we're going to get into, that'll be a lesson in and of itself when we get to the mystery of the Trinity, but that's a few weeks away. Now, H, the matter, M-A-T-T-E-R, and the matter and the energy that makes up the universe, along with space and time, were created with the universe. Matter and energy, space and time, are the stuff of the universe and came into existence with the universe. So what happened, I guess, from a theological point of view, at the Big Bang, is that all of a sudden, matter, energy, time, and space just sprung instantly into existence. I, are you on Roman numeral I, or no, letter I there? The universe was created out of nothing. This is what we believe as Christians. The universe was created out of nothing, and that is also the Jewish understanding. This is the doctrine of creatio ex nihilo. You like that? That's Latin. Creatio, everybody? Creatio ex nihilo. Now you can impress your friends that you know Latin. Creatio ex nihilo. Creation out of nothing, that's what that means. Matter, creation out of nothing. The universe was not made from anything that existed before the universe. There was no pre-existent stuff. When I go and build a house, I have to go and get materials that already pre-exist to do assemble that. If I'm going to paint a painting, I have to go and buy the paints and the canvas and do all of that. Pre-existent stuff to my work of creation. Not so with the universe. It came out of nothing. So there was not any pre-existent lumber and concrete that God used to build the universe, from which God made the universe. There was no pre-existent stuff. And we can't even conceive of that. That's an inconceivable thought. Yes?
Is Big Bang, like the Big Bang theory, is that separate?
We don't think so.
I just thought of it as, like, if you're thinking like more scientifically, or, oh, it just happened versus God creating the universe. But it's...
We as people of faith say that that's the emergence of the universe out of nothing. Science would say it's the emergence of the universe out of a singularity, but they don't know what that singularity is. And they can never know what that singularity is. Mm-hmm. As people of faith, we'd say, that spark was from something outside the universe that had intentionality,
right,
and had a lot of power. And we call that something, someone, God. The nature documentaries call it nature. Whoever she is. Okay. Now, Roman numeral 3. Creation and science. Science has been able to discover the processes of creation at work within the universe through the use of the scientific method. Which I want to say again, who invented the scientific method? Theologians. There is no contradiction between what science has discovered and what the Jewish and Christian traditions have affirmed regarding God's role as creator. Science may be able to tell us to a limited degree the what and the how it happened. The Jewish Christian faith tradition tells us the who and why. Two different questions. Religion is asking who and why. That's what theology is asking. Science is asking what and how. So the Christian faith tradition tells us the who and why behind what happened. Therefore, here's the following statements. Christians can affirm that the age of the universe that science has determined. The universe is some 13.5 billion years old. No problem. There is no need to reject the scientific evidence concerning the age of the universe. Now, when I was in an undergraduate school and seminary, I had a professor who believed literally in the chronology of the biblical texts and numbers that they gave. We'll get into this later. And they will insist the universe is only 6,000 years old. And then, and I was just like 18 or 19 years old, and I raised my hand and I said to the professor, yeah, but we are receiving light from stars that are further away than that. Would that suggest that the universe is much older than 6,000 years? You see, I didn't know much science, but I did pay attention to my science teacher in high school. And this is what the professor said. He said, well, that is because God created it to look old. And I'm trying to wrap my head around this. And he said, yeah, I created it look old. Well, look at it this way, Peter. When God created Adam, he created Adam to be a 30-year-old man, not an infant. So Adam, even when he was a day old, was actually had the appearance of looking like he was 30 years old. How he arrived at the age 30, I don't know. But a part of me, I can only disagree with the professor so much, but part of me wasn't buying it because it just seemed to me that God is playing tricks with us. He's making it look like the earth is 4.5 billion years old, but we really know that it isn't if we have faith. So all these people are being misled because God has faked the evidence. That doesn't even sound like a moral God. Yeah. So I just could never buy into that. And science now knows exactly how old the universe is. And I believe that science is right in telling us that. And it's completely compatible with our faith.
Don't dispute it, with legit arguments. I know I've been in that discussion before. And it's a visceral.
Yeah.
It's a passionate position.
Yeah, fundamentalist Christians do insist they have to because of their particular way of interpreting these ancient texts. But you do not have to interpret it the way they interpret it. And in fact, Christians historically have interpreted it they use a different interpreting methodology. So there is no real problem with what science is telling us and what we read in the biblical texts. It's how you interpret those texts.
Is that fundamentalist view a relatively modern view?
Yes, it is. St. Augustine said, you cannot take the creation stories in Genesis literally. St. Augustine, that's 5th century.
Wow.
He said, don't take it literally. You can't. So, and he didn't have the benefit of modern science, and he knew that. So sometimes we become very simple-minded when we approach these questions. Okay, B, Christians can affirm that life evolved on the earth for billions of years and that higher forms of life evolved from lower forms and that all living things are related in a great web of life. There is no necessary contradiction between the discoveries of science concerning evolution and the Jewish Christian doctrine of creation. They are compatible. I emphasize that. It's a matter of how your method of interpreting ancient texts. And you got to be really careful with ancient texts. They're not scientific texts. They didn't have science back then. Okay, so I want to bring you now to another page called Five Cosmologies. And you can pick one. Oh, I got to make you more copies of that. Do we? Some of you are going to have to share because I didn't make enough. The office may not be open. Okay, who needs? I want everyone to have one in front of them. Okay, you can have one back. There you go. Okay, and
I. My baby one.
Yeah.
This is just one copy.
Wait.
It's just one copy of the cosmology.
Yeah. Okay, so you can go. That can go back over there. Who doesn't have this? And I'm sorry, I'll make more copies of it.
We're all
good now. We got it
settled. Y'all say, you're looking at this page? Okay. Here's your choice. There is what is called monism, which comes from the Greek word for the number one. All things are one in being. sharing one common substance, essence, or nature. This one being is eternal and infinite. So that's one way of looking at all phenomenon. It's all the same thing. Then there is pantheism. Pantheism is all things participate in the divine reality. Everything is divine. Everything is a part of God. Everything is God. All of reality is God. The universe is eternal and infinite because the universe itself is a part of God. And in fact, you're God. That's pantheism. Okay? Where does pantheism... pantheism is... very much a big part of, as far as what I'm told and what I've read, a part of Hinduism. Hinduism is pantheistic. Then you have something that has been a very compelling point of view called dualism. In dualism, you have, there are actually two original beings or two eternal realities. And they identify them as matter and spirit. They coexist eternally side by side. They are co-eternal, co-equal. All reality is an amalgamation of these two eternal beings coming together. This is the thinking of Socrates and Plato. It's called dualism. Then there's emanationism. All things eternally and infinitely radiate out from the one, which we call God, in a series of emanations. This is Neoplatonism, and that's also a very, I really like this. I mean, there's a kind of an intellectual attraction to it. What it is that the one, we'll call that one God, the source of everything, is like the sun, and all of the universe, the cosmos and creation, it's not that God is an artist putting it together, calling it into being. It's like, you know how the sun just radiates light out? God, the one just radiates out all of reality. And the further the emanation, it's a series of emanation, and the further the emanation is away, the more primitive and less like the one from which it came. So there's a hierarchy of being here. The closer you are to God, like the angels and spiritual beings, the more like the God they emanate from. And the further you're away, like things like inanimate objects are further removed, you know. Whatever you think is on the low end of the objects of existence. So that's Neoplatonism, and it's always been that way. So basically they're saying it's eternal. The universe is eternal. We already know that the Hebrews and consequently the Jews and the Christians says no, the universe is not eternal. And what's interesting is that contemporary science is backing that. We now know the universe isn't eternal. This is why they come up, those who do not want to believe in God and make God the cause of the universe, come up with the multiverse. It just pushes it back further, but ultimately you can't have infinite regression, you know. There has to be a bottom line somewhere. Okay, theistic creationism, and this is where Judaism, Christianity, and Islam come together on. There is only one eternal original being, that's God, who creates all things in a willful and intentional act. All things that exist are derived beings from an eternal original being and acts who acts with purpose and intent. God is to creation as an artist is to art. All things are created from nothing. So those are the five cosmologies, and there really isn't any beyond that. Pick one. Okay, I'm gonna get, I read off this and someone could have had this. I have my own here. I'll give it back to you. I'm sorry.
Has there been any, there has to be some end.
Oh, for the end?
How long?
that is not under this topic. We'll get to that in probably in about 5 months. Okay. It's called eschatology. And then we'll talk about the date of the end of the world. I'll just keep you hanging there for until that time. I'm pretty sure it's not going to happen before we get to the lesson, so you'll be okay.
Need to buy any more shoes.
Now, there's... Now, how did the ancient Hebrews view the universe? And it's really important that we see clearly that they had a very different idea of how the universe was. Do you got the diagram that I sent you? Do you have a copy of that? Yeah. This is how the ancient Hebrews, and by the way, the ancient Mesopotamians, because the Hebrews got all of their ideas about the nature of the universe from the Babylonians, from Mesopotamia. This is how they viewed it. And you can, this really makes sense. If you go outside and you look at the sky, have you ever noticed it looks like a dome? Mm-hmm. So they, just by observing it, they thought the sky is a big dome that is this like big dome is resting on the earth, on the mountains. Because there was mountains they couldn't climb. So therefore, that's where the dome of the sky is sitting, like a big dome. And the earth is a disc that's flat. After all, common sense tells you it's flat. I mean, you could go over the edge. And this disc is supported by subterranean pillars. And what the pillars are resting on, they never could figure out. And so... you had waters above the dome. Imagine that the dome is encased in water above. We know now it's outer space, but that's how they imagine it. And that the stars and the sun and the moon were somehow on the inside of the dome, moving around. You know, when you go into a church and you see the dome and there's like stars painted there, that's how they imagine how the earth was. And so I point this out to you because... the writer of the book of Genesis, or the writers, I'll put the writers there, this was their understanding of the universe. This is how they understood the universe. So when they wrote the creation poem, and it is a poem, and I emphasize that, it's not a scientific explanation. Never take it as a scientific explanation because it'll drive you crazy. It isn't. It is a poetic expression. That's how they viewed the universe, as this dome. They had no idea that there were galaxies and all of that. They had no idea how truly enormous the universe was. They thought in this very limited way because that's how it appeared to them. And really, if we didn't know better, that's how it would appear to us. If you had no scientific knowledge and I took you aside and I said, that's a big dome and the stars are glued up there moving around and all that, you would believe it because that's how it appears to us. And so when the ancient Hebrew writers were writing these texts, they were writing it within the cultural context of their time. This is how people 3,000 years, 4,000 years ago, 5,000 years ago saw the universe. So when the Hebrews shared that same understanding, but when they wrote the creation story in Genesis, they were not trying to give a scientific explanation, they were trying to give a theological explanation, which is much different. So what they were saying, in view of the best science of their day, whatever it was, God did it. God did it. That's the significant contribution and the genius of the Hebrew mind. And what they were saying was something theological, not scientific. So now I want you to go to that page that I think I gave you called the Hymn of Creation. Are you with me so far? Okay, go to the Hymn of Creation. Now, Michael,
yes, sir.
If you be Lector 1, and then I would like for Adelia, if you would be Lector 2. Okay? Then Angelica, be Lector 3. You have to share it, but we're going to have ones made for you. And then You have an extra one? Because you can share one. Okay. Oh, here's an extra one. Anybody need one? You're good? Okay. Here, Kristen. Okay. Okay. All right. So did I get Lector 4 yet? No, I was going to assign Lector 4. Lector 4, I'm sorry.
Kristen.
Will you be Lector 4? And then who would like to be Lector 5? Anyone? You want to be Lector 5? Good. Do you see where you're reading? Okay, good. Excellent. And then Tony be Lector 6. Okay? And I'll be the leader. And I'm doing this deliberately because I want you to see something here. The purpose of this text. This is poetry. And in particular, it's liturgical poetry. This was sung and chanted in the temple in Jerusalem. And you think of poetry with the right brain, not the left brain. This is not a scientific explanation. I want you to experience this hymn and how they would have experienced. We're going to read it, not chant it, but it would have been chanted. So it's a beautiful poetic work of art about creation. But you'll begin to see in this poetry the way they imagined the universe. Okay? You're going to see it. You probably never read Genesis like this before. So let's make this a prayer as we read this together. I will begin. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the abyss, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the primordial waters.
Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness God called night.
And there was evening, and there was the morning, the first day.
Then God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters." So God made the dome, and divided the waters which were under the dome, and from the waters which were above the dome. And it was so. And God called the dome the sky.
And there was the evening, and there was the morning, the second day.
Then God said, "Let the waters under the dome of the sky be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters he called the seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth." And it was so. So the earth brought forth grass, and the herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind. And God saw that it was good.
And there was the evening, and there was the morning, the third day.
And God says, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs, and for seasons, and for days, and for years. And let them be for lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. So God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night. God made the stars also, and God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, so to rule over the day and over the night, and to divide the light from the darkness, and God saw that it was good.
And there was the evening, and there was the morning, the fourth day.
Then God said, "Let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life, and fowl that may fly above the earth in the open dome of the sky." So God created whales, and every living creature that moves, which the waters brought forth abundantly after their kind, and every winged fowl after their kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let fowl multiply in the earth.
And there was the evening, and there was the morning, the fifth day.
Then God said, let the earth bring forth the living creatures after their kind, cattle and creeping things, and beasts of the earth after his kind. And it was so. So God made the beasts of the earth after their kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creeps upon the earth after their kind, and God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make humankind in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created humanity in God's very own image. In the divine image did God create them. Male and female did God create them. So God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. Then God said, behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree in the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for food, and to every beast of the earth and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creeps upon the earth wherein there is life. I have given every green herb for food, and it was so. Then God saw everything that had been made, and behold, it was very good.
And there was the evening, and there was the morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them, so that on the seventh day God ended the work which he had made. And God rested on the seventh day from all the work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it God had rested from all the work which God created and made. And there was the evening, and there was the morning, the seventh day. You see how this has the cadence and the wording of a song. Not to be taken literally, but the theology here, because everyone would have said that the creation, there was a dome and all this kind of thing. No matter what the universe turns out to be through our observation, ultimately, it's God who created it. That's the point. That is a theological point. God is ultimately responsible for the existence of the universe. That's one observation. Another observation is that God takes the chaos of the primordial waters and brings order to the chaos. So he divides light from darkness, dry land from sea. You notice all the divisions that were taking place? God is organizing his creation. The other thing, and the most important thing, other than the fact that God created it all, is that humanity was created in the divine image. Every human person possesses the Imago Dei. The Imago Dei means the image of God. You bear within your very person the divine image. Now, that doesn't mean that God has a nose and God has digits on a hand and that God has red hair. Doesn't mean that. What it means is that God is personal and relational. And what makes us in the image of God is that we are persons and we are relational. That is where our image lies, and that is where the dignity of every human person living in the world is. So every human person bears and carries within their very person the divine image. Those are powerful theological statements. One is, if God is the creator, he has a will and purposes for this creation. And the creation doesn't belong to us. In fact, we're creatures. We're like creeping things, creeping on the earth. That's one thing. So it gives a sense of humility to us as human beings. Secondly, what this says is that humanity has a special dignity, because there is something in us that resembles God. Another thing that this poem tells us is that everything that exists, exists because of the will of God. It's the product of intentionality. Now, when you go outside in the course of your week this week and you look at everything, you ask the question, is this all some kind of accident that just happened? Or is it the product of intentionality? And that's the question that we live with, and that is a theological question. And when you start asking questions like that, you're doing theology.
All right.
Okay, let's close in prayer. Okay, everybody.